I'm Sterling Council, born and raised from Camden, South Carolina, and I'm the founder of Beyond the Court. College Circle was where it all started at. My pops put the ball in me and my brother's hand, I'd say around about 5-6 years old with the rec department. And from there, we didn't look back. You know, my brother was a football and basketball player. I focused mainly on basketball, but coming up, we played all the sports. But it got serious for me around, middle school. You know, once I got into middle school, I knew this was something that I wanted to do. One thing I can say, though, with the game of basketball, it's a lot of emotions that come with this round object. And whatever sport you do play in, whatever thing that you do, and you put, you're all in it. So, I can say from the outside looking in, it probably looked like it was easy for me. But it's this one story that I had. I remember, after my high school career, I had to make Player of the Year All-State. And I felt like I'd done all that I could do at the high school level. But I had a hard time qualifying. And a lot of people don't know that. So that's why a lot of schools didn't give me a shot. They said I was too small. I was too slow, but my biggest problem was that I had a harder time qualifying. People that don't know what that means, that's, getting the scores you need to get into an NCAA playing house. So I remember walking on this street. I used to always dribble the ball as a child, just to get my handles right. In the neighborhood, I used to just dribble and think about the game. But I remember, after taking the test, wondering when a scholarship gonna come, making calls, my AU coach making calls and things of that sort. Just wondering when a scholarship gonna come. And not being able to pass the ACT, I took it 3 times. I was just crying, man, wondering if I'm gonna be able to play the game of basketball. Because like I said, this is all I knew. This is all I wanted to do. And I always had dreams of playing at the next level and one day playing professional. So this screen right here, it gives me a lot of memories because, this is where it all started, like I said. Eventually, the last time I took it, I end up, USC Aiken end up giving me a shot.
Hold me. Call me the captain.
Just play.
They say family that plays together stays together. And one that walks apart just falls apart. So together we stand, divided we fall. United we form Voltron and take on.
After getting accepted into, finally getting accepted to Aiken, I didn't qualify until our first game of my freshman year. I remember like yesterday, we was playing Clemson University. And I reported to college August 16th on my birthday every year. And I still wasn't a qualifier. Head coach at USC Aiken, Prince Alexander, pretty much told me, you still haven't qualified yet. Our first game was, like October. So we played Clemson, I qualified. I got the news that I'm eligible to play first half. But still, my first year, I didn't play a lot. He threw me in there second half, end of the game, we was game going out. But that's when I qualified. So, like I said, that whole first year, it was eye-opening because, I went from playing a lot in high school to not coming off the bench at all. So I was bitter, I had an attitude. Like I said, we was the number one Division II school in the country at the time. So it was just a big transition. So I got kicked off two times that year because of my attitude, which I don't have a bad attitude, but it all spent off because I wasn't playing. So I was mad about the whole situation and I didn't redshirt. So it was pretty much a, eye-opening, like I said, and it made me, work harder. It made me, man up. And I hit up my AAU coach, like, coach, I want out. I was looking to transfer, but at the same time, with the pride I have, I didn't want to give my coach the satisfaction of, okay, I'm gonna leave. So I just, worked harder and, tried to do what I had to do to get on the court. Fast forward, my sophomore year, I started playing. I started
I had a good year. My junior year, I had a good year. Then it took a left turn. We, you know, brought in another point guard. And like I said, the game, you know, college is all business. That's what, you know, a lot of kids need to realize. They don't care about your feelings. They don't care about what you're going through. You know, it's all business. It's all about making that coach look good and him winning games. If he ain't winning games, he's going to find somebody to recruit over you, to bring in, to make sure he win games. So my college coach brought in another point guard, you know. So, you know, it was like, okay, what you going to do? You know, it was a different type player. He was a 94-foot point guard, up and down. I'm more of a half-court point guard. So my senior year, I ended up coming off the bench. So it was another, you know, slap in my face to like, okay, I had to perfect a whole different role now. I was starting my junior year, I started my sophomore year, but we brought in another point guard and it made me have to, you know, figure things out. So I had to play this role and coming off the bench. But at the same time, the end of the season, I led the team in minutes, you know. So, you know, that was my role, I embraced it. I did what I had to do. I ended up being, you know, I was nominated as All-American that year, Peach Belt Conference, you know, top players. So I had a good, you know, good senior year and a solid, you know, 4 years, you know, at USC Aiken. That was, you know, that helped me be the man that I am today. So it was a good experience. Like I said, I had a decent 4 years. Agent contacted my head coach at USC Aiken, and it was two agents, and I was, you know, trying to figure out which one I was going to, you know, sign with. I knew I wanted to play after college. Like, that was always a dream of mine. So the NBA as a kid is always, you know, something you want to do, but, you know, as time go on, your goals got to get realistic. So, you know, the NBA was far-fetched. So once I got to college, you know, you start to hear about playing ball overseas or in high school, later in high school, like you can make a good living playing overseas. So that became the goal, was to play overseas. So a guy by the name of William Wright, you know, reached out to my head coach, asked about me, and he flew down, met with my family. I ended up signing with him. By the time we had a game plan together, this is what it's going to be. This is how we're going to set this up to, you know, to play. So I just knew I wanted to play after college ball. And, you know, it ain't worked out how I wanted to work out. He had a couple situations for me. I went and worked out in Vegas for two summers. Went to a Eurobasket camp and, you know, try to get myself more out there. Because, like I said, it's hard coming from a Division II program. Like, it's, you know, it's possible, but you got to be that much more special because that basketball rim is very competitive. You got a lot of players trying to, you know, play overseas or play in the NBA. So it was tough. It was difficult. Then I got injured, hurt my ankle. That set me back. And like I said, when I left college, I didn't finish my degree. So that was always in the back of my head. You know, I had my situation with the ABL. I went and played in Panama for a season. Things off the court. Didn't play how I was supposed to play out as far as financially. They stopped paying us. So my agent got me a flight back home. So it was back to the drawing board. And but that's pretty much how I played out from high school to college and from college going to play overseas. So like I said, man, a lot of, you know, got a lot of toughness, you know, playing on the blacktop, which is, you know, outdoors. You know, this is one of the parks that we, you know, we were playing in every Sunday. We used to play pickup at a young age, playing with grown men, and I think that's where I developed an IQ for the game. And, you know, we're playing, just playing pickup ball. So, this is right here, just walking park, you know, the tracks. This is where a lot of us play pickup basketball. My advice to, you know, any young kid that's wanting to play at the highest level, regardless of the sport you're playing, whether it's, you know, football, soccer, baseball, whatever sport you're playing, perfect your craft. Don't look at somebody else's story or somebody else's path and think that's how you're supposed to play out. Things play out different for different people. You may have to go through a lot of hurdles, a lot of triumphs, a lot of, you know, injuries and things of that sort to get to where you want to ultimately be. But it's something that you believe in, and you believe you can play and you can, you know, perfect your craft. be coachable. A lot of kids right now, you know, it's a lot of attitudes right now with, you know, a lot of these young kids that I see. Even coaching now at the high school level, I see a lot of kids that, you know, have a lot of attitudes in coaching. Coaches ain't gonna deal with that at the college level. So, or even at the high school level, really college, because it's all business. You can easily get recruited over. Your scholarship is only year to year. So every year you gotta re-sign a scholarship. So if you ain't doing what you're supposed to do, you can easily be trying to find another school or back home. They don't care about your feelings. And that's what I really want kids to understand, that got the chance to play at the next level. They don't care about your feelings. It's all about wins and losses. If you ain't putting them in the best position as coaches to win games, then it's the next man mentality. So stay focused, you know, believe, stay in the school books, get your grades, qualify. That's another thing kids don't understand. You gotta qualify. NCAA clearinghouse, you gotta be eligible to play in the NCAA. So just perfect your craft, stay in the gym, and be a student of the game. Learn and, you know, try to do whatever you can do to put yourself in the best position to play at each level of the game. Since my playing days has been over, life been quite interesting. Now I've been, I knew I always wanted to be around the game of basketball. So my coach, high school coach, Coach Ron Mackey, probably one of the best coaches I ever, you know, had, you know, from a player standpoint. That's the guy that gave me all the confidence I need in playing basketball. So I appreciate you for all you've done for me. You know, the position you still put me in. So now I spend a lot of time with the high school program, varsity basketball, working under him as an assistant. From there, I had a situation in South Korea where, you know, a close friend of mine, like a brother to me, Murphy Holloway, he put me in a position to where I was able to go over there and do some player development. That experience was eye-opening. It was a great experience. It was different culture. The biggest thing about that was, you know, they didn't speak English. But other than that, I had a great time. Due to COVID, I had to come home early. And I was planning to do a 2-year contract, but due to COVID, it kind of shaked everything up and kind of messed up my situation. So as of right now, I came back home. Like I said, Coach Mack, you know, always has the door open, wide open for me. So I'm spending a lot of time with the varsity program. We're currently in season right now, so I'm helping them out at the current moment until I figure out what God got next for me. So still in the gym, working kids out, coaching basketball. And, that's about it. In my path of life, I have many regrets, but one regret as far as dealing with basketball is I kind of wish I would have went the prep school route. You know, after high school, I visited a prep school called Fort Union Military Academy, me and my family, up in Virginia. And I didn't know too much about the prep thing, as it's so relevant now today. That's a route a lot of kids are doing. And I wish I probably would have went the prep school route. The only thing about it was a military. When I went to visit, and talking about waking up 5 a.m, wearing military suits and all that, I knew on the ride back home, I told my parents, I can't do that. You know, I wasn't trying to do that. But if I knew then what I knew now, that would have been the best route. I would have been able to get, you know, better scholarships. I would have been able to focus on just playing basketball, getting stronger, getting quicker, because that was a lot of the weakness in my freshman, sophomore, junior year. Freshman, sophomore more so was my speed. I wasn't really prepared to play the style of play that my coach was playing in college. The prep school route will be my only regret, I would say, and I'm probably putting in a little bit more work, you know, being more dedicated to the gym, you know, working out a little bit more and things of that sort. So other than that, you know, like I said, you know, you go through certain things to, you know, to build your character, to see how much you can take, see whether you're gonna fold or you're gonna keep persevering through whatever you gotta go through. So other than that, that'll be the only thing that I would change for my story, because if I wouldn't have gone through those things, beyond the court wouldn't have been about. So I just feel like, you know, God tests me in a different way all the time, even, you know, future years I'm gonna be tested. So just handling that adversity when the time do come will prepare me for whatever I need to do.
The Honor Court came about from a dark place that I was in, transitioning in my life. After I left school, I didn't finish my degree. You know, I was two classes away, but my dreams was always to play professional basketball. So I ended up signing with an agent, a guy out of DC named Wright Sports Agency. And I wanted to pursue my professional career, so I ended up signing with him. He had some situations for me lined up to play overseas. From there, you know, I got a deal in the ABL.
I just wanna be successful. I just wanna
I packed all my bags. You know, I told my family I wasn't coming back. So that was my first chance to play professionally. So, you know, I packed all my bags. Went out there, you know, I did enough to make the team, so I made the team. On the flip side of that, once I made the team, month in, everything was going good. But, you know, as time went on, things off the court wasn't right. So financially, I wasn't in a good space. I was struggling financially. Then they stopped paying us. We got one check. They stopped paying us. That's the side of the story. A lot of kids don't know, like playing overseas or, you know, you may not get paid on time.
This me, you'll never hear a reply for it.
So now, like I said, I went there financially unstable. My degree's still in the back of my mind. So, you know, I was still in contact with my advisor. My advisor told me, you know, you got to, if you want to get your degree, you need to do it in a year span. Or if not, the credentials would change. So I made my mind up once I got finished with here. You know, I packed my bags. We ended up leaving early. I was gonna go back to school. So I enrolled in school, rolled back that USC Aiken, took my two classes. I was out of seat.
My way, but as of late, a lot of shit been going sideways.
Unfortunately, I failed those two classes. So I failed the classes. I ended up having to take them again that next semester. You know, so this was the last chance I had to get my degree, because if I would have failed this next go around, then I would have had to start all the way over, because, you know, you can only fail one time, you know, before you had to change your degree. So I had to lock in. My agent hit me up again. I had a situation in Canada that he wanted me to go work out for. But unfortunately, my advisor said I couldn't leave. I had to stay on campus because it was my capstone classes. So long story short, I had to buckle down. I ended up passing those classes that second semester, and I got my degree. That was tough for me, but at the same time, it built up a lot of courage in me, a lot of fight. I had to be determined to get through and finish it what I started. So that 1 year span gave me a lot of perseverance to know that was probably the toughest thing for me. Reality was setting in. So now after that was over, you know, I realized that basketball window was closing. So now it's like, okay, I'm here for the summer. The whole time I was away, I was in Panama. Now, I always wanted to do a camp. I had some older mentors, a guy by the name of Pooh Abrams and Harvey Camps, Harvey Council, who camp I grew up in as a childhood to my olderhood. I always wanted to camp once I got in the position to do a camp. So, you know, while I was away, I always thought about, you know, what I would name my camp. So it took me some time to ponder on the name, you know, bouncing ideas off with my family. And I came up with the name Beyond the Court, you know. So that name was pretty much steered about of, you know, life after basketball, you know. So that was the whole meaning behind the name.
Oh yeah, Trey,
so the name Beyond the Court came basically off of that, you know, my trials and tribulations with playing ball, but at the same time being crippled by the game of basketball, because I never worked, you know. My parents, you know, put the confidence in us, you know, if this is what y'all want to do, y'all focus on doing such things, whether it's basketball. My brother played football and basketball. So, you know, that was my focus. So by the time I finished school, it was like, okay, dang. You know, they tell you need a degree. I got a degree. Now nobody want to hire me because I don't got the experience. So what now? That's the main reason that Beyond the Court name came about. And it reminds me daily that I don't want to never feel like that again. So that's a space I don't want no kid to, you know, to feel. But eventually you got to go through certain, you know, adversity to determine your character, to see if you're either going to fold or you're going to keep pushing forward. So that's really why the name of Beyond the Court, you know, came about. I felt like it's only right, you know, because, you know, this is where I was born and raised. This is where, you know, I had the most confidence in my game, playing under my coach, Ron Mackey. So once I got it, like I said, once I got into position to do a camp, it was only right, you know, to do one here in my hometown, you know. So Beyond the Court is really based on Camden, South Carolina, and that's really my main focus is Camden, South Carolina. I mean, the reason I started with camp is because, you know, basketball is the bridge between the gaps. So once I could get him in his gym, you know, now I have the attention span to bring different other pieces, you know, other people in to the picture. So camp, the basketball is the platform, you know, so a lot of kids like to play basketball. So I try to use that platform to bring in, you know, to get their attention to where now they can gravitate to whatever, you know, we have to talk about or whatever we have to, you know, teach them. So, you know, with that platform, I try to bring in different faces, professional faces, as far as lawyers to come in to talk, real estate people. We have a partnership with Mid Carolina where they come in and talk about financial literacy, different aspects of life, just to, you know, give kids the hope to know that they can be anything they put their mind to, you know, whether it work on the court or off the court, you know, just, you know, put the time in and see how it play out. The way you can support the music, the movement, first, you know, bring your kids to the camp so they can, you know, learn, you know, good skills to be good basketball players as well as good individuals. You know, I have a clothing brand you can support by, you know, being a part of, you know, the clothing. Well, it's with the camp, you can sponsor kids through camp. You know, my goal is to eventually, you know, have a, you know, a nice camp, you know, the way it stays relevant from year one to however long God see it playing out in the future. So there's different ways you can, you know, be a part of it, you know. Just enough of all your problems, too much to kill you. And when I leave, I always come right back here. The young spirit of I want to thank the community, Camden, South Carolina. I want to thank everybody that support me. I want to thank, you know, my family that's been there with me from day one. I want to thank my high school coach Ron Mackey, probably one of the coaches that, you know, the coach that gave me all the confidence I needed when it comes to the game of basketball, right here in this gym. So I want to thank him, you know, for putting me in the position that I am now to be able to come back and do my camp here every summer and give me open arms. So I want to, once again, I want to thank Camden, all my sponsors that help with the camp, and everybody that support Beyond the Court. Anybody that ever purchased anything from me, anybody that ever bought a hoodie or a t-shirt, whatever the case may be, or even just sponsored a kid, it's greatly appreciated, and I thank you. My advice on anybody trying to start a brand or a business is, first, find something, do something that you believe in. That's the first thing, because if you don't believe in it, as soon as things don't go your way or it ain't playing out how you thought it should play out, you'll back out, you know. But if you believe in it, you're going to keep pushing it. If it's a good, you know, it's coming from a good place, from the heart, it's a good cause, and you're gonna keep pushing it to make sure, you know, it flow how you want it to flow. So believe in what you're doing. Don't listen to the people around you that say you can't do it. If you believe in it, you do it, you know. Put yourself in a position financially to where you can put up your own money and, you know, start small. You know, work at your own pace. Do things at your own speed. Don't, you know, because we live in a world of social media and you see things
You know, we all want, you know, the world we live in, instant gratification. But it don't work like that. If you believe in it, keep pushing it, keep doing it, keep pushing it. Eventually, the people that's not supporting you will support you. And when it comes to support, don't focus on the people that's not supporting you. You know, the ones that do, you pay attention to those, you look out for those, and you know where your love comes from. So that's my biggest thing. Just start it, you know, start it, don't procrastinate. You know, make sure it's coming from a good place. Put your own money up and believe in whatever it is you're doing. You know, the support will come, you know, support will come.